This is the Blood Red Podcast from the Liverpool Echo.
Well, Jose, I mean, it's great to be able to chat to you this morning. Just wanted to basically run through your spell at Liverpool and then ask you a little bit about, you know, how you've been and so on, and take it from there. But we'll take it back to when you first joined the club in the summer of 2011. It was a big year in terms of spending at Liverpool. You had the likes of Luis Suarez and Andy Carroll, yourself, Stuart Downing, and Jordan Henderson. Obviously, Kenny Dalglish was in charge. I mean, there seemed to be loads of optimism around the club at the time.
Yeah, obviously, that's why when I had the chance to join Liverpool from Newcastle as well, obviously, was obviously apart from the history of the club, was as well, obviously, that you could see that the club wanted to grow even more, wanted to win titles again, and we did that season. We won the Carling Cup. Obviously, Luis Suarez and Andy Carroll, they arrived from January because obviously Torres went to Chelsea. Mm-hmm. But yeah, even that summer, they spent a lot of money in players, and for me, it was a very, very good project. Obviously, you kind of, well, now it's 6-time Europe champions, but then we were 5, and obviously, you cannot say no to a club like this. So for me, it was a big step to go into it. Obviously, I was adapted to the Premier League because I was already 4 years in Newcastle. So for me, like I said, it was a big move, and a move that it was amazing for me.
Yeah, I mean, Newcastle, obviously you know that, but it's a massively supported club, huge fan base. Was moving to Liverpool, similar kind of passion for football as Merseyside and Tyneside, but was moving to Liverpool a huge kind of realisation that this club that you've joined now is one of the world's elite?
Yeah, you know what when I see the most different, because like you say, in the cities, in both cities, the support is incredible. You know, Newcastle, they live for Newcastle. And in Liverpool, I don't care how many blues they are, but they live for the Reds, you know, that's the reality. and that's the truth. And obviously in that, you see a bit, you can compare a bit, you know, you say, okay, they live for their club in their cities. But then when you realize more, it's obviously in pre-seasons, when you go on holidays. When I used to play for Newcastle, wherever you go in the world, to be honest, not many people recognize me, to be honest. And when I used to play for Liverpool, was a big step on that. Like, we used to go, me and my partner, places and go, like, people like maybe go to Dubai or whatever, and a lot of people there stop me and go, and I want to aim me. Well, there you see the difference. No, you can see worldwide how many fan base this club have, and you know, you could see a lot more difference there. Obviously, like you say, in the city, yeah, Liverpool fans are great. For me, are the best in the world. Newcastle fans are amazing as well. But like you say, you can compare a bit in the cities. They live for football, you know, both of them.
Yeah, and obviously when you joined Liverpool, you were playing under Kenny Dalglish, who is the biggest legend of them all at Liverpool. I mean, how did you find working with him, and what would you like to play for?
With Kenny, is not just apart from signing me, apart from that. To be honest, in English football, obviously Newcastle, I was learning English from the start, and I didn't know about, obviously I knew Kenny Dalglish was a big player, but until I arrived to the club, I didn't really know how big he was really, Wow, when I arrived and he signed me and then people start talking to me about him and everything, I was like, okay then, I know who he is now, you know, and I have massive respect for him because, like many people know as well, he signed me for the Legends as well when I retired. So obviously I'm playing for the Legends because of him. That's the reality. So he signed me twice. Not many players can say that about King Kenny, you know, so I will always be grateful to him. He's always been incredible to me. And when I arrived to the club, he gave me so much support as well. So I know it's very difficult to understand him sometimes because he speaks really, you know, really strong English, you know, but he's an amazing man, you know, obviously an incredible manager. And to be honest, I didn't understand. Obviously, I was happy with Brendan after it, but I really didn't understand the Sahim with all of Kenny, to be honest, because the reality, we didn't finish the best on the league, but we arrived to 2 finals that season. We won one of them. So I believe we did a good season. Obviously, in the league, we should have improved it. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, that's one thing I was going to ask, actually. I mean, you played 35 times in the Premier League in that first season. You obviously won the League Cup and narrowly came up short in the FA Cup final. I mean, how did you sum up that first season as a Liverpool player looking back?
I believe I have a great season. I believe my first 6 months, they were the best, to be honest. I don't know why after, I'm not sure why. I dropped a bit my form at the end of the season, but my start at Liverpool, it couldn't have been better. To be honest, the fans, they were behind me from the start. They make us on very, very quickly as well after 2-3 games. So I can't say one bad thing about that. So obviously, like you said, we could have been better on the league probably. But at the end, we won the first title since 2005 with the Carling Cup. So I was happy. You know, my first season, obviously, we then finished in the Champions League. And maybe that was the target on the league. But we won a title that we know how difficult it is. I know it's a cup. Obviously, it's not the Champions League or the Premier League. But doesn't matter which title it is. It's always important and very difficult to win any.
And then Brendan Rodgers came in 2012 and you played 29 times for him in that first season. How was the adjustment to him and you know, what were his ideas that were kind of different to Kenny Dalglish's?
Well, to be honest, as a fullback, he didn't change my game. To be honest, I tried to play for both the same. I was really offensive fullback, tried to give my best for both of them. It's true that Brennan was more in 20s, was more modern, if you want to call it, like manager. Obviously, he's a lot younger, and the 20s was really, really good fun, you know, like in terms of heart, but really good fun, you know, a lot of football, a lot of ball, and, you know, like, was really nice. I was really happy under Brennan, to be honest, as well. But like I say, it's not much. Yeah, apart from trainings, football-wise, yeah, Brendan tried to maybe play more the ball in the floor, more like a Spanish tiki-taka, he used to call himself, yeah. Like this one, he used to do that. So, yeah, you know, like try to play more football. And Kenny Moore was more like the old-fashioned, more like more passion, more, you know, like courage and, you know, different, good, both of them, and but different, yeah, definitely different.
Yeah, I mean, Jordan that season, mid-season, the club signed Philippe Coutinho and Daniel Sturridge, and the team started to play a little bit more like what many assumed that Brendan Rodgers was going to bring. I mean, I think you scored one of the best team goals of the season against Swansea. Was there a feeling inside the group at the time that, you know, the club and the team had started to build towards something? Because that was how I kind of felt watching from afar at the time.
To be honest, like you said, at the end we signed players like Coutinho, that we signed him for 8 million, if I'm not wrong, and in that time, and I don't know how Inter Milan let him go, to be honest, with such a young player with so much quality, you could see him from the first day. And then Sturridge the same, and I believe he was very unlucky with injuries, Sturridge, but he was a top class when he was fit. You know, the season that we nearly won the league, you could see he made such a big difference, you know, with Luis Suarez, really. So, like I said, we had a team with Brendan and we nearly won the league as well. And I believe Brendan did well for the club. Obviously, it happens that Luis Suarez left. And when a team player like that left, that it was the most important player of our team, 100%, it was going to be difficult for him, you know. But I believe he did a great job for him. I believe he will come back to Liverpool as a manager, obviously not now. Let him Klopp be the next 20 years the manager of Liverpool at least, you know. But I believe, obviously, he improved as a manager as well, because obviously he's more experienced. Look, the job he's doing at Leicester, the job he did at Celtic before as well. But I believe he done a very, very good job, and he was a great man as well. So Brendan is a manager that I believe he's up there with the best, and he will show that, I'm sure.
Yeah, he's someone who I think he speaks a few languages, and you mentioned that he tried to kind of bring in a Spanishy type of style. I mean, I think that was one of the reasons that he was made Liverpool manager, because he was young and he had these kind of fresh ideas. I mean, how did he kind of get you trying to play? I mean, because it's difficult as a fullback, because you're expected to be solid at the back, but you're also expected to contribute so much going forward as well. I mean, did your game change in any way at all, or did he just let you play your natural game?
He let me play my natural game, to be honest. He told me, like, Jose, you do what you know. You play in Spain before. You know how I like fullbacks to go forward and try to attack as much as possible. And obviously, at the end, the most important, you are a defender. So try to defend your winger. But as soon as you can, just go forward and try to damage that way. And obviously, I did that. You know, for me, with Brendan, but even with Kenny, I have freedom, you know, to do what I wanted. I was obviously to push forward as much as possible and try to defend well. So I have no one complaint, and maybe any of them say, no, Jose tried to be more defensive, more the opposite. Both of them give me so much freedom to play my football.
And the following season, the 13-14 campaign, where the team nearly won the league. I mean, Alex Sissoko was brought in on loan, and And John Flanagan ended up playing most of the second half of the season in your position at left back. I mean, there were some injuries involved there as well with yourself. I mean, how do you reflect on that time where the team were flying, but you didn't probably play anywhere near as much as you would have liked?
Well, I didn't play, first of all, because I was injured. Obviously, I had my knee. After that, you could see my career went like from being like that to go like that straight away. After that knee, I never recovered from that injury. That's the reality. To be honest, it was very frustrating because obviously Flano was flying, you know, when he played, and he did really, really well. But I believe in that season I was doing really well until I got injured, and I could help the team as well, like I was doing the years before. So like you said, at the end of the season that was so beautiful, obviously it didn't finish the way we wanted, obviously with the Premier League title. But that a season that it was that beautiful, I believe it will always be there, you know, that I wanted obviously to contribute more to the team. But the reality is if I could have done something more, I would say, well, maybe I have some regrets about it. But the reality, I couldn't. My knee didn't let me play. I was training one day, resting two, training one day, resting two. So you cannot be a Premier League player that way. That's the reality. So obviously it took me time to accept, and it was hard to see from the stands, but that's why I didn't play, you know, and I needed to accept it.
Yeah, so in your eyes, that was the big turning point of your Liverpool career, was it, picking up that knee injury, which, you know, took you off the team for so long?
Yeah, for me, definitely was that, because I believe I was doing great in the third season as well. That was my third season as a Liverpool player. I believe I was the starting left back. Obviously, I needed to push every single game and play, but I was playing every game. Even injured, Brenna was playing me because I played 2 months with a meniscus tear, my knee, that not many fans know about that, but I played for 2 months with the injury, taking so many tablets every single day just to play. And I wasn't even training. Sometimes I just training Friday and playing the weekend. So imagine. Mm-hmm. By one point, obviously, my knee, even with painkillers, they didn't let me play that way. So obviously, we tried to get the operation, and it was more damage than we thought. And after that, like I said, I never recovered from it. I never was the same player. I was sometimes training really, really well. So happy, you know, that maybe I have the chance to play. And then my knee didn't let me, you know. So yeah, that's what ends my Liverpool career and my football career, really, because then I went to Zaragoza and I had 2 years contract and I just played one and I left it. So yeah, it ruined my career, that knee injury, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, it must be nearly impossible when you're not training all week. And you mentioned that you're training on the Friday and then expected to perform on the Saturday. I mean, that must be, you know, as I say, impossible to be able to do properly.
Yeah, and as well, because like you said, because obviously you're not training enough physically, you are obviously not as good as everyone else, and then mentally wise as well, it's very tough, because I was in, like I said, obviously the first few weeks after the injury, it was hard because I need to take painkillers and everything like that, and my pain went away, but in one point not even the painkillers take my pain away, because it was that damage that they couldn't take the pain away. I was having injection, I was having so much stuff, really, that I don't want to say, too many drugs to say, you know, obviously take that pain away. By one point, I couldn't. So in one point, my knee was really, really swelling. I said to Brendan, listen, I don't know what's happening in my knee, but obviously something going wrong. I cannot play. I cannot turn. I cannot play my football. I'm really frustrated. And obviously, like I said, after, obviously, with all the recovering, it took me maybe a meniscus tear, the one I have, the sternal, it takes you maybe 2 months. And for me, it held all my career. So imagine, mm-hmm. because it damaged my cartilage in my knee because I was playing with it. So it was a lot of things wrong in that at the end it ruined my football career, not just my Liverpool career, my football career, really.
Yeah. Let's move on then to the arrival of Jurgen Klopp in 2015. I was listening to you tell a story a few months back where you said he got everyone in the media room in Melwood and kind of paraded around all the staff and said, these guys are here to help you and learn their names and get to know them as people. I mean, that's it. That story kind of just sums up the kind of collective, you know, togetherness that Jurgen has instilled at the club. I mean, what were your initial thoughts that, you know, when you found out he was going to be your manager?
Well, obviously we knew how good he was because obviously he saw it for Dortmund, but obviously, like, you know, other managers are very good, but until you don't have them, you don't know how good they are. You know, obviously, you know how good they can be because you can see that. And like everyone, he didn't play under Klopp, they say, oh, he's the best manager in the world. Yeah, but when you're training with him, you realize why he's the best manager in the world, you know, and how much intensity and how much hours and work he put into it. But like I say, for me, what he done, Brendan did as well. Obviously, he didn't make a meeting like that, but in Kenny as well, all the managers I have in Liverpool, to be honest, obviously Klopp make it more specific, and something that for me it changed more was, for example, the trips when it was national teams, and he took all the families instead of just the players, and obviously because he knows that, and now many clubs does, Guardiola does, Mikel Arteta does, and they didn't before, and they do now. And it's good because you realize that at the end, it's true that footballers, people just think when they see Liverpool, they just see the starting level or the 18 players that they are in the squad plus the manager, and it's so many people behind, so many people working in the club that make the players play that way, you know, and the families as well. You know, the player, if he's not happy at home, you can see that on the pitch. And when they are happy at home, you can see that on the pitch too. So Klopp wanted to make sure that the players' family as well, they were happy in Liverpool. So how he does that? Try to put them together, try to obviously, between the women, be friends with the kids and everything like that, so they are more happy and the players can focus more in football. So it's something that you think about it now and you say, oh, it's normal, yeah. But no one done it. It's done it before, you know, and it's something like, it looks very silly, but it's true. You know, at the end, players, we have people realize that we are, obviously, I'm not anymore, but when I used to be, we are, you know, like normal people, you know, like, and you have your life after football. You're training until the middle of the day, and then the rest day, you have your family, or if you are single, you have your friends, or alone, or whatever. And it's so important that you feel love and you feel like you have people around you. It's so important, you know, in any city that you are in. And Klopp, what he did is try to make the players that they are really to be really happy in Liverpool. And I believe that's what makes the club now its identity, you know, like every single one. But like you said at the end, when he did that as well on the media room, he shows every player. We knew the players that we already there, but for the new players as well, how important it is. So many players, so many people working behind the players that they never mention. People on the kitchen, people on the gyms, physios, you know, on the offices, like, and they are incredible. I'm telling you, I always say that as Luis Suarez, Pepe Reina, and they play for big teams, Bayern Munich, Barcelona, teams like that, and they tell you that they never seen people in the class that they work as good as they do in Liverpool. So it's so important you give that importance to them people, because without them, I'm telling you, they will not be performing the way they are in the pitch. 100%.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people from the outside know about all the tactics with Jurgen and the way he presses and the way he plays with that high octane style. But what you're telling me there, it sounds like he's a perfect man manager as well. Is that something you'd agree with?
For me, it's like that. For me, it's like you say, obviously, then he's fantastic in what he does. Because for me, the most difficult thing when you've been a footballer, you realize, for me, look, he can make a fullback run. He can make a midfield run. But how you can make them three, top front three, you know, run that match defensively and offensively, that's the difficult thing. Because normally your stars, you can see Cristiano, Messi, obviously, these two are they were in a different level at their best. But you could see, yeah, you give them the ball, they make the difference, but defensively they don't give you all you want. But you need to accept it. They are the best, and it's what it is. But these three, they are for me, the best front three in the world, or one of the best front threes in the world, and they work as much as the midfields or the fullback. That's the difficult thing, and that's what Klopp is did. And if it's no Mane or Firmino or Salah, then it's Jota, and if no Jota, it's Minamino. Minamino, look now how much difference he's done since he signed. How much work rate he put now into it, and that's all to the, obviously all to the player. He need to have the attitude, but you need someone that is your boss to tell you what you need to do. And Klopp, like you say, he's brought that to the team, and then Liverpool as a family as well, not just the club as well, as the fans as well. They feel like we are all together, we are one, you know, and that's what Klopp, for me, is different to everyone else in the world.
Yeah, and one other thing he did as manager was give you the captain's armband at Liverpool in that FA Cup game against Exeter. I mean, I can tell just from speaking to you, Jose, how much you still still love the club and how much of a feeling you've still got for it. So looking back when you were captain of Liverpool for that game, you know, that must have been incredible for yourself that night.
Well, to be honest, obviously, I don't know if I deserve it, probably don't, you know, to compare, you know, to be a captain of Liverpool, because for me, when you be a captain of Liverpool, you have to be someone that won many things and everything like that. But I believe Klopp have a detail there with me because he knew how hard was that season for me. He knew, he was really honest with me from the start, because obviously it was Alberto Moreno playing in front of me and Brad. Mm. And he told me, say, Jose, listen, they told me how good you were. He said, I didn't know you before here. Obviously, I was working in Germany, but they told me how good you were as a player. And I see that in trainings many times, but I need a player that can play every 3 days. And you are not able to. So it was hard to hear that, but obviously he didn't tell me that way, you know. Obviously he told me more nicely, but yeah, he told me that way, you know, and you appreciate that. You appreciate it honestly. And he was always really, really honest to me. And he's a man that I will always appreciate for that. And then in the most difficult moment, you know, that I was leaving Liverpool was one of the saddest days of my life and my partner's life as well, to be honest, because we were really happy there. Apart from obviously my injury, he went in a cup game and said, Jose, you're going to be the captain of the team today. And that will stay with me. I have the captaincy somewhere here as well in my office. I kept it. So, and it will always be something that I have there with me, you know. So even it was really hard and my knee injury and all of that, Klopp have a detail with me, you know, there. And I will always appreciate that from him.
Yeah. Just a couple more questions then. In 2018, moving on from your time at Liverpool, you were diagnosed with obviously the rare tumour. Obviously, a very scary time for yourself and your partner. But reading up on a few of the things you've said about it, it almost seems that you were surprised by yourself and how positive you were to kind of, you know, tackling that head on and getting yourself, you know, healthy once again.
Yeah, to be honest, it was, like you say, and I say, obviously, it was strange. It was very strange because it was like, look, when you retire from football, from any job, that's why it's so much, I believe, it's so much depression and so much bad times when people retire when they are 65 or 67 in the UK or whatever, you know, that they retire because you've been doing, obviously, it's not the same in football. It's a short period of time where you were maybe 12 years, 13, 15, obviously, depends when you retire. In my case, obviously, I retired. It's something that it wasn't in my control. I didn't retire because I wanted to retire. I said, okay, it's time to retire. No, I retired because I couldn't play any more football. So to accept that was really, really hard. And I have a lot of mental health issues with that, a lot of problems with that. And then all of a sudden, I have a tumor. And in a very, very strange way, it's like a focus again. Okay, I need to get well. You know, I need to be, you know, I don't want to die. I want to live. You know, so I have a focus again. It was like, okay, do everything the doctor says, have your treatment, have everything, and you'll be all right. And I was really positive. Obviously, I have my bad days, don't get me wrong, like everyone, and more than times with the treatment and everything. But I was very, very surprised how positive I was. Obviously, it came more after my recovery. You know, that I expected I was going to be the same person as I used to be in terms of, obviously, physical. And I wasn't. I have some ear problems. I have some eye problems. And obviously, my ear is gone. It's completely perfect. My eye is still bothering me a bit. It's really dry. In this one, for example, I don't produce any tears. So it's really hard when I watch too much TV or I make too much interviews. No, I love that. No, you know, when I talk on the PC, on the laptop or the phone. So it was more after it. But to be honest, it was something I changed my life forever, and I see life completely different. So that's why, obviously, something that we will talk about, I'm sure about now, is about switch. You know, like it's something that it changed my life for good. You know, it's in a wrong way, in a strange way. You know, like
I
see life completely different now, completely different. Yeah. You know, like when you retire from football, you believe everything is gone and everything is finished, and the best moment of your life is gone. And in a way, it's true, you know, because being a footballer is unrepressible. That's the reality. But then when it happens that to me, you see other ways that you say, wow, I'm really privileged. I'm a football legend as well now. I'm working with Switch as well. So I'm a privileged man, mate, you know. So you have to accept that. And that's what we want to show a little bit with Switch. That obviously we will talk about it more now. But it's is that, you know, that it changed my life for good, definitely. Yeah.
I mean, it does seem that, like, one of the key reasons for you signing up for the campaign is all about health and you know, promoting that healthy living. And you're someone who's obviously had ups and downs with injuries and you know, health issues. But you've played for two huge clubs in England and in Spain as well. I mean, you know, you've experienced a lot, and it seems like that is something you're keen to promote at the moment.
Yeah, for me, listen, I have to. For me, you know, like, when you feel better with yourself, you know, like, you are more happy. That's the reality. Mm-hmm. And that's what streets try to do, you know, like, obviously, in my case, I love hit sessions, you know, because obviously in football, you know, it's all about as hard as you can and all of that. But other people maybe like yoga, other people like maybe meditation, other people like maybe shadow boxing that I tried the other day, and I still have some cramps in my back here. You know, everyone likes anything, you know, different. And switch that what they try to do, you know, try to help people. And for me, I really identify myself with them, you know, the way they want to help people. And like I say, exercise for me, is science, you know. You produce more endorphins, you are more happy with yourself. And when you look better, you look more happy with yourself because you put new clothes, you put whatever. Obviously, everyone, we have our standards, you know. Everyone wants, for me, it's quite extreme. I try to be really ripped, and you know, I don't advise that to anyone because I'm really strict, you know. But everyone, we are happier at some points, you know, that. Mm-hmm. But when you are more healthy, eating more healthy and do exercise and everything like that, you are more happy. You like to put more clothes on, you like to obviously take care more of yourself, you are more happy. And for me, something I do daily, and it helped me so much with my mental health, not physically, just physically wise, mental health. That for me is something that I didn't believe on it before, in mental health issues. I believe it was for people that maybe they weren't right. That's the truth. And maybe many people that didn't have it, they think that you know, psychiatrists or psychologists is for people that really are maybe not well, you know, mental wise, or they have a problem. And it's not true. It's mental health is more in the life of people that we really know. Look, just yesterday, a ex-player that used to play for Manchester City, the young team, and killed himself. Yeah. I just seen in the news this morning, and he was a really young player. So it's everywhere, you know, mental health issues everywhere. It's very difficult in the world right now, and more with all that's happening, be positive. And we switch, but that's what we're trying to do, you know, try to be, people love football, obviously. You know how much support I have from Liverpool fans and Newcastle fans. So here we put something that they try to be closer to me and to switch, to exercise, to mental health, to help themselves to be more happy in a very difficult situation right now. So that's the message, really.
Yeah. Well, just finally then, looking back, I mean, it's been a few years since you left Liverpool, but you still get a chance to play in the Legends games, as you said. Just from what I see, it feels like you've still got a massive love of Liverpool Football Club. I mean, you just kind of sum up, you know, what it means to you a few years since you left the club.
For me, I said in an interview not long ago, because people were asking me about Newcastle, about this. I said, listen, I want to make it clear, and I believe maybe you've seen it because I did it on Instagram. Liverpool for me is everything. The way the club treated me while I was there. And don't get me wrong, Newcastle, they treat me amazing when I was there, and the fans, they were incredible with me, and they still are, you know. But Newcastle, Liverpool has been something that I step up in every single way, you know. Like, the most important thing for me is you see the people that really love you when you are in the worst moment of your life. And in the worst moment of my life, when I retired and with my tumor, Liverpool, in this case, Peter Moore, was the first one to get in touch with me, you know, and they offered me all the help I needed from LFC for anything. And then, like in a trip, I went to Barcelona to see the game that we lost against Barcelona 3-0, so I didn't give too much luck to the team that day, so that's why I didn't go to Anfield the second one, you know, and we beat them 4-0, obviously, after it. And I was very surprised by Kenny there. I spoke to him, everything. He said, Jose, how are you feeling? I said, I feel good. You know, he said, to play football, how are you feeling? I said, oh my God, then maybe sign me for the first team. You know, like, you know, he said, no. I said, I feel perfect. He said, what do you think about playing for the Legends? And I said, well, that will be incredible. I'm not even, you cannot even call me a L, you know, say a legend, you know, like, it's incredible. You know, I said, well, of course, you know, it will be incredible for me to play with these players, you know, again, and to put that shirt again. He say, okay, let me sort it out with the club. And straight away, they put me and make a trip to Hong Kong. That was one of the best trips of my life because I went with my partner as well. We stayed there for 10 days. So obviously we stayed even more after it. Yeah. It was like to play for the first team. You see the playing for the legends, how they treat you there with the securities and everything. I said to them, why the hell we have securities? They say, no one care about us anymore. You know, like, why the hell we have securities here? You know, like, but it was the treatment, like I said, from LFC is incredible. Then I went to Barcelona to watch that game and the fans, I remember Alberto Moreno did give me the wrong tickets and he put me with all the fans in the top, you know, with all the Cop fans. And how they treat me that day and how they were singing, like, I don't know if it was 2,000 or 3,000 fans, away fans, and how much they were singing through while I was walking. I have even a video about it and how much care really they were drunk, obviously, and but they didn't care, you know, how drunk they were. They were so careful with me because they knew I just had an operation on my head, and how much they take care. And every time I go there, because I go to the, obviously not now, but I go to the UK quite a lot because my partner is from there, is from Bolton, and I go to Liverpool a lot because one of my brothers lives in Liverpool actually. And every time I go there, it looks like I still playing. Seriously, like how people treat me everywhere I go is unbelievable. So, like I said, this club is everything for me, and it's what I feel for Liverpool. Even watch yesterday, I never done that in my life. Yesterday, I couldn't watch the game, you know, against Sheffield United. I couldn't watch it, and yesterday I watched so many football now, so much football because of my work of being an agent. But first of all, what I did was watch Liverpool, you know, the game again, and I say, okay, yeah, let's see how they play it. So it's, and it comes from me. It's not like, oh, I need to do it. No, I do it because I really want to watch the game. Yeah. It never happens to me that before. So that's why, like I said, LFC for me is everything. The club and the relationship I have with the club is something very, very special. That's why they say once a red, always a red.
Always a red.
And it's true.
Jose, thank you very much. Brilliant.
Thank you, mate. Thank you.